has used some information operations tactics, sometimes in conjunction with their other operations, tactics like blackmailing military members or man in the middle, where they insert a Russian operative in between conversations. Can you talk a little bit about the information operations piece of this and how we see them even expanding that perhaps beyond Ukraine to non-battlefield situations?
Right. So in Ukraine, I mean, what we saw in some cases during the early part of the conflict where most of the fighting was done, but what someone coined pinpoint propaganda. So basically, soldiers would have their cell phones out there, which you really don't want to have in combat, but we're kind of, everybody seems to be dependent on these things. So they would have them out there. They would get, you know, an artillery barrage would come and hit them. And then right after the artillery barrage, they would get, everybody in the area would get a text on their phones that said, you know, is your corrupt oligarch president worth dying for? Go home and protect your family. Right. So it can have, you know, real effects if you have, right, in the U.S. I don't think that would have a major effect on our soldiers. But in Ukraine, where you had a president that would have an approval rating at like 15% or something that would rival our congressional approval rating, then you're going to, right, it can have a real effect. And so tying those together, and you see, and kind of to broaden that, where do you see it going beyond that? I mean, to the Russia, again, what they kind of perfected after 2008 Russia-Georgian War. They were trying to, you know, argue that it was a responsibility to protect, and they were protecting the South Ossetians from the aggressors, which were the Georgians. But the Georgians kind of, you know, both sides were somewhat at fault, but I think more people believe, hey, the Georgians were, they were preempting a Russian aggression that was going to happen no matter what. So they were just going to do it on favorable terms. So it was preemption by the Georgians. And the Russians kind of like, hey, we lost this, you know, major IO information operation that was trying to blame the Georgians for the start in it, and we were going in to protect. And so that's kind of, you know, the reinvesting in RT and kind of this just misinformation, right? Just enough misinformation out there so that it buys them time.
Due to various moral and legal considerations, the U.S. often can't or won't apply similar tactics in its hybrid warfare as perhaps Russia would, for example. Does this mean that we're handicapped in the information operations field? How do we think about defense versus offense, and how do we engage?
I mean, I think it provides them some advantages, I guess you could say it. It doesn't handcuff us. I mean, rightfully so, we don't want to do influence. It's hard with right internet where it's just you don't know who you're influencing and you can't influence American citizens. So it's challenging in that regard, but it doesn't mean you have to concede defeat on that. I mean, we have the same problems with right countering violent extremism. What's effective against that? How do we go in there and do that? I think it's just more being aware and smarter about it. So, okay, we know they're trying to influence elections. Well, let's, you know, okay, you can try to take down websites and work with that. But, you know, part of it is also having a slightly smarter electorate so they aren't going to fall prey to that. And you're not going to get them all, but try to influence the ones that really are trying to make an informed decision. And so it does give them some advantages, just like the same thing. They aren't going to – them and a lot of enemies we face aren't going to follow other rules of war, right? They're going to – I can't think – I mean, every mosque I ever went to in Iraq, it was an ammo storage depot, right? Because they think we aren't going to go in there because it's a place, right, a protected site. But you can go in if you need to. The same thing. They'll put their, you know, artillery systems right next to schools, hospitals, those kind of things, you know, making us force our hand and worry about collateral damage.
It seems that often we are reactive instead of proactive, especially when it comes to false narratives or fake news stories. So denying a story rather than pushing out proactive narratives. How do you see particularly the defense community, but the larger administration or the larger U.S. government responding to this? And if you don't, how do you think they should be responding?
Yeah, I mean, it's there's examples out of Russia. I mean, we know Russian have been all over the Donbass, the eastern part of Ukraine, and it just kind of never makes the news, right? And it's clear that they're in there and commanding and controlling a lot of those Russian-led separatists, but we don't kind of show what they're doing, right? That's, you don't have to necessarily counter their fake news story. Let's just show what they're actually doing. Let's just, I mean, don't even really, to some extent, give credit to their false stuff. Just show what they're actually doing in that case. But, I mean, it does play into the Russians' hands. I mean, early on, I mean, most Western leaders didn't want to get involved in Crimea. They knew who the little green men were. But it gives them, you know, arguably plausible deniability. I say deniability because I don't, almost nowadays, almost nothing's plausibly deniable. But it allowed them not to act until it was a fait accompli and they had Crimea. And then it's too late. So, yeah, I think it's a challenge.
So maybe one final question, if I could. You mentioned earlier the challenge to the monopoly on violence that cyber sometimes plays, the monopoly on violence by state actors. Do you see us moving towards this dystopian science fiction novel version of warfare where you have guys in computer-filled rooms fighting remote wars, or do you think that that is a pure fiction and it's always going to be a hybrid combination?
I mean, the monopoly of violence has been eroding for years, right? The you know, information, explosives, right? So that's been going on for a long time. Will we ever get to the point where, okay, I remember a Star Trek episode with you know, Captain Kirk, and he was at some planet and they were fighting a war where he's like, what are you doing? They're like, well, I'm reporting to the disintegrator because they just bombed us and killed 200 of us. And he's looking around like, what bombs? He's like, well, it's all simulated now, but we take away the violence other than we still get killed. And he's like, what is this? So he, you know, violated the Prime Directive and screwed him up, tried to stop him from fighting wars that way. But fundamentally, war is a human endeavor, right? And it always will be. Technology will play a role in that. You will have some automated systems in doing this, but it's not going to be Terminator machines fighting wars. It's going to be humans fighting wars. And as we constantly forget that, then we're going to be putting ourselves at a disadvantage.
Okay, well, Colonel Collins, this has been a really fascinating discussion. Thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us today on Root of Conflict.
Thank you.
Thanks to all of you for listening to this episode of Root of Conflict. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcasts. Also, be sure to check out the many podcasts under our umbrella organization, the University of Chicago Public Policy Podcasts. That website is www.uc3p.org.
This podcast is partnered with the Pearson Institute for the Study and Resolution of Global Conflicts. For more information, please visit their website at www.thepearsoninstitute.org. This podcast was engineered by Mwangi Tuita, edited by Yini Wang, and produced by Mwangi Tuita. The views expressed are not intended to reflect the official positions of the Department of Defense or any other government entity.